Isaiah tells us, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice. From that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." Let's pray together. Father, we simply come before your throne again this morning in celebration. Father, acknowledging that in the same way that you told us that your Son would indeed come, he did. And Father, certainly while maybe his coming was not what many expected, Father, we realize that he has promised to come again. Father, certainly he will fulfill all the promises of God. Father, give us hearts that long for his coming. One of the things that the nation of Israel should remind us is, Father, they desired the Messiah. And Father, may we desire the coming of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that he might reign forever. Father, we thank you that today he desires to reign in our hearts and in our lives. Father, may we realize that, acknowledge that, and allow that individually, that each one of us make that decision to allow Christ to rule and to reign in our lives. For it's in Christ Jesus' name we ask and pray.
If you would stand with me, please. Sing with me.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of ages. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Sing, choirs of angels, sing in exultation. Oh, sing all ye bright hosts of heaven above. Glory to God all, glory in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the Lord. Let's worship and adore. Let's worship and adore him. Let's worship and adore him, Christ the Lord. For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy. For he alone is worthy, Christ the Lord.
Amen. You may be seated.
from afar, the wedding water, the wine. Now it's done, they've taken her son, wasted before his time. She knew it was true, she watched him die.
Thank you to our choir. We had breakfast this morning, our children's Christmas breakfast, and had a good crowd over there, and appreciate all the folks that helped prepare the meal for us. But thinking about, you know, now that it's been an hour plus and you've had all of that food, I mean, I saw Steve Jackson, he had to get help to carry his plate to the table. And I don't know where he's at now, but if he's back there working security, somebody keep him awake back there. I meant to talk to the members of the band. When I saw them taking their instruments out, I meant to tell you, no, take them back to your seats. I may need you to blow on those and wake some people up during the service after that breakfast. I saw Wolfenbarger yawning back there just now. So I saw his plate was full too. So we've had a good morning, and I can't believe, I thought I was maybe not have a lot of time this morning, but somehow got more time than normal. And we'll see how that goes. But I promise we'll try to stay awake for all of this, and I need you to do the same thing. So grab your Bible and turn with me to the Gospel of Luke, the first chapter. And, you know, always at Christmas time, you're thinking as a pastor that, you know, obviously a great reason to celebrate and to rejoice. But we all know the Christmas story so well that sometimes you feel this pressure to say something that say it in a way that maybe it hasn't been said before, and then you start suddenly realize it's probably not possible. And so we just want to focus in on this passage. And I've been thinking about this Christmas, and I've been wanting to talk about the divine announcements, the angelic announcements that God gave during this, what we celebrate as Christmas. And so we're going to do that starting this morning with what is simply and beautifully called the Annunciation. And that was the divine angelic announcement to Mary of the birth of the Christ. And so Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 26, we will read the Annunciation. Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also that Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God nothing will be impossible." Then Mary said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. May God bless the reading and the hearing of his word together this morning. In many ways, this is quite simply the greatest and the most beautiful story that's ever been told. It begins here in Luke's gospel with the divine birth announcement, the Annunciation. Luke writes for us a historical narrative. He wants us to have a historical account of what has happened. Verses 1 through 4 of his gospel tells us of chapter 1, that's exactly what he set out with the intent to do. And so he begins that by proclaiming this announcement to this young girl named Mary that she would indeed give birth to the Son of God. It's an amazing story in so many ways. It's an amazing story in the fact that God didn't choose Judea, but Galilee. He didn't choose Jerusalem, but Nazareth. Martin Luther marveled that he didn't choose perhaps the daughter of the high priest, but an unknown, were her name not in Scripture, village girl. It is amazing. And I want to walk through this narrative, and then I want us to learn some lessons from Mary herself. She is for us a model for those who would experience the birth of the Savior in our own lives. But that is indeed what we need and should desire to do. We'll begin with that angelic approach. That in the sixth month, and we're told later on what sixth month we're talking about when the angel clarifies that in her own relative, Elizabeth, that she has conceived a son in her old age, and it's now the sixth month with her who had previously been barren and was certainly too old for that to have changed apart from the miraculous intervention and work and hand of God in her life. And so in that sixth month, this angel has approached Mary, sent by God to the city of Galilee. named Nazareth, to a virgin who is betrothed to a man whose name is Joseph, and that man is of the house of David. Her name is Mary. Gabriel was an angel sent by God. I won't take the time, but in the book of Daniel, when Gabriel appears to Daniel in Daniel chapter 8, Daniel essentially falls to his face. And at the end of that chapter, he literally says he was sick for days. Because we're right here in Luke's gospel, I'll have you look back at chapter 1, verses 11 through 13, and look at what happened to Zacharias when he had an encounter with the angel at the temple. It says that the angel of the Lord appeared to him standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zacharias, for your prayer is heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John." Skip on down to verse 19. And the angel answered and said to him, "I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God and was sent to speak to you and bring you these glad tidings." Zacharias, the priest in the temple, is frightened by this angelic appearance. Could you imagine what it was like for Mary, a young girl, in the year of betrothal to Joseph? Mary, much like Nazareth, was seemingly insignificant. What we do know is that most Jewish girls were essentially entered into an agreement of marriage. Oftentimes their parents made the agreement. And then they would enter into a betrothal period. That period could last up to, but usually not exceeding, a year. And oftentimes in our conversations about Mary and Joseph, we'll like to point out that she was a teenage girl. Oftentimes you'll hear people say that she might have been 15 or 16, and to be honest with you, I think that we like to use those terms because that somehow seems maybe acceptable to us. It's a bit of a stretch, but we can kind of understand 15 or 16. The reality is that most of these Jewish girls were betrothed at the age of 13. Usually the marriage ceremony, the wedding feast, the week-long celebration happened around the age of 14, and not always, but often. So the truth of the matter is, Mary may well have been simply a 13, 14-year-old girl. It's hard to imagine. But she presents herself to the angel very humbly. She even says of herself later on, verses 46, 7, and 8, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for he has regarded the lowly state, or the humble state, of his maidservant." She acknowledges that God and the angel acknowledged that she came from a humble place. She was simply recognized by the simple grace of God. Says that the angel came in and said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." When she saw the angel and heard what he said, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. To consider means that she tried to discern. She pondered the meaning of what the angel had said. It is the same word and idea that is given to us in the 119th Psalm, the 78th verse, that says, "I will meditate on your precepts." She is meditating, she is pondering, she is considering, she is contemplating what has been said to her. And many have contemplated what has been said to her. And unfortunately, at times, have really gotten it wrong as a result of the Latin Vulgate and the translation that they use that says, "Hail Mary, full of grace." And that translation has been taken to the idea that Mary had all the graces and the gifts of God. And that she somehow, instead of being the recipient of divine grace, became a dispenser of grace. That's not what Scripture teaches, and that's not what this verse means, and it's not a good translation of the language. Instead, she is the divine recipient of divine favor. God's good grace in abundance on her life. And she acknowledges that, and she realizes that. And with that, we have the angelic annunciation itself, that Gabriel declares that the virgin will conceive. We learn of his mission. She will give birth to a son. Let's read it again, verses 30 through 34. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." I'll pause there and come back and consider 34 in just a moment. But we learn that his name is to be Jesus. That name simply means Savior, or Jehovah saves. Joseph had received an angelic visit as well, and the angel told him the same thing. "You'll call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." He will be the Savior. That is why we are giving him this name. And then he goes on to explain some other things, and without taking the time, I just want to look at them very, very quickly, that are going to be true of this child. He will be great. If ever there was an understatement, that's it. It is an unqualified greatness. He is great in all ways. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Highest. This is a very clear explanation that he is the Son of God. And the Lord God will be with him and give him the throne of his father David. This is a fulfillment of the Davidic covenant given in 2 Samuel chapter 7. He will reign over the house of Jacob, in other words, over the nation of Israel forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. His kingdom will not end. Again, a further explanation of his fulfillment of the Davidic covenant is given. He is the promised Messiah. He is the Savior. And then Mary responds to the angel with a simple question. How can this be? I do not know a man. She's still in the betrothal period. Her and Joseph have not come together and consummated the marriage, which they would do after the wedding feast. She says, how can this be? Do not mistake her question for disbelief. As a matter of fact, it is belief that causes her to ask the question. She essentially believes what the angel has told her. She believes it to the point that she said, how is this even possible? Because I know how I can be with child, and that hasn't happened yet. So how is this possible? It is not unbelief, but belief that causes her to ask this question. And then the angelic explanation is given. Verses 35, 6, 7, and 8. Gabriel explains to her that with God, all things are possible. Now think about this for just a minute, because we're looking at three or four short verses, and in those verses, essentially, the angel is going to explain to a 13 or a 14-year-old girl the incarnation, the Trinity, and the working of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, those are some pretty profound theological truths. And that is what is being revealed to her in just a few short words. the Holy Spirit, he says, will come upon you. The power of the highest, the power of God, will overshadow you. Therefore, also that Holy One, the Son of God, who is to be born, will be called, we're given the Son of God. There they are, the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, the Father, the Son, all three right there. In the words of an angel to a 13 or 14-year-old teenage girl. First of all, the fact that the Holy Spirit will overshadow you means to surround, to encompass. It literally just means the very presence. It's the idea of the Mount Sinai being covered, or the Mount of Transfiguration, the glory of God being present. That means that God is present. There is no hint or suggestion of any sexual overtones or sexual unions in this passage of Scripture, as some have tried to suggest. Scripture doesn't suggest that. What Scripture does suggest is that this is a miraculous virgin birth. And as we consider that, it is for every single one of us who would believe in God, there is a miraculous event that happens within our lives. The very presence of God shows up through the life-giving work of the Holy Spirit that comes upon us and bestows life within us. Think about it for just a minute. The Son of God was born that you and I might be born again. And the angel explains to her that with God, nothing will be impossible. Think about it for just a minute. To acknowledge God means that the impossible is impossible. There is no impossible. There's nothing that God cannot do. I hear that phrase and I cannot help but think ahead a little bit in Luke's gospel. Take your Bible and turn with me there for just a minute. And then I want to come back and make some observations about Mary and we'll close. Luke chapter 18. Jesus has just been talking to the rich young ruler. And he has instructed him that he lacks one thing, and tells him to sell all he has, distribute it to the poor, and you'll have treasures in heaven. Come follow me. When the rich young ruler heard this, he became very sorrowful, for he was very rich. In verse 24, Jesus saw that he became very sorrowful. He said, "How hard is it for those who have riches to enter the kingdom of God?" And then he said, "For it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven." Upon hearing that, those who heard it said, "Who then can be saved?" And Jesus said, "The things which are impossible with men are possible with God." The things that are impossible with men are possible with God, for with God nothing will be impossible. Not a virgin birth, and not the salvation of a lost sinner. Not the fact that you and I, sinful and unrighteous, can be declared holy and righteous in the sight of God because of the incarnation. And because of his sacrifice and substitutionary atonement in our place on the cross of Calvary. But apart from the incarnation, there would be no substitutionary sacrifice. The incarnation set those things into motion for us. And you and I, just like Mary, can be overshadowed by his presence. Literally, her womb, that very term, that idea of being overshadowed by his presence. And I mentioned Mount Sinai and I mentioned the Transfiguration, but it's also the idea of what happened in the Holy of Holies. And literally, her womb became the Holy of Holies. What an amazing thought. But from Mary, I believe that you and I need to learn some lessons. She is a model of those who would experience the birth of the Savior in our own lives. And because some have made too much of Mary, we have shied away and at times made too little of Mary. And there's some things that we need to learn about her. Let me give you four of them. First of all, I think we need to learn from her humble spirit. I mentioned it already in her Magnificat. She proclaims that God would even pay attention to this lowly servant. She demonstrates the humble spirit that Jesus proclaims in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, verse 3, when he says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." We must acknowledge our own spiritual poverty. Mary acknowledged her humble state. She did not see herself as somehow glorified, but as humbled herself before God. We need to do the same. We need to acknowledge our spiritual poverty and our need for a Savior. But I also think we need to demonstrate her reflective nature. I love the fact that she considered the things that the angel had said to her, that she thought about them. She tried to discern and ponder what they might mean. You and I need to do the same thing. We need to consider our lost condition and realize our need for a Savior. And then realize what the Scripture tells us, that God demonstrated His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We should stop and consider and think about that and then decide what are we going to do with it. Which brings us to the third thing that we need, which is a believing heart. Belief is so important. Jesus, in that conversation that he had with Nicodemus, reminds us that whosoever believes, we must believe. In the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul explains this very well in chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, when he says, "If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved." And Paul explains, "For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." To believe is important. We must, as Mary did, believe. She demonstrated her faith when she asked, "How is this possible?" She believed what he said. And then lastly, a submissive will. A submissive will, a willingness to surrender and submit to God. Romans 10:13 declares that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Mary said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." She said, "Let it be exactly as you have said." She reminds me of the words of other men and women of Scripture. She reminds me of the words of Job, who said, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust him." She reminds me of the words of Isaiah, who said, "Here am I, send me." The words of Ruth that said, "Your people will be my people and your God will be my God." Are the words of Esther, who said, "For such a time as this, if I perish, I perish." The words of Mary, "Let it be according to your word." Listen what she said, and I say this all the time. She believed God's plan for her life. Listen, did she have a plan for her life? You better believe she did. She was betrothed to Joseph. You can rest assured that they had dreams and plans, and suddenly they're interrupted with this annunciation, this divine announcement, and she believed that God's plan for her life was the best plan for her life. And I say this often. It is my prayer for you and for I and for each and every one of us that we will come to the place in our lives where you desire what God wants for your life more than you desire what you want for your life. That's where she found herself. "Let it be according to me. Let it be to me according to your word." I believe God's plan for my life is best. And she submitted to Christ. The mother of Jesus was a disciple of Christ. If you turn on over to Acts with me for just a minute, Acts chapter 1. She is gathered there in the upper room with the followers of Christ. It says that they all continued, verse 14, with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. She's there. She continues to submit to the will of God for her life. She is not just the mother of Jesus, she's a follower and a disciple of Christ. And I want to tell you this, that's the last time you see her in the pages of Scripture. We don't talk about Mary again. Now look, if God wanted her to be more than the mother of Jesus and a disciple of Christ, he'd have told us more. But he didn't, because she's not. But she is for us an example of what it means to experience the birth of Christ in our own hearts and our own lives. We must have a humble spirit. We must have a reflective nature that sees our need for a Savior. And we must have a believing heart that believes that the impossible is possible with God. And then a surrendered and a submissive will that follows Him in obedience. Do you have those things? Have you demonstrated those things? Don't let Christmas pass without Christ. Submit to Him and His lordship of your life. Let's pray together. Father, we come before your throne thanking you for your love. A love that would send your Son. Father, just unimaginable to the human mind, and I would imagine even angelic minds. I can't help but wonder if Gabriel or any of the other heavenly host, I don't know what their understanding of even their assignment was. The incarnation that God would clothe himself in flesh. That he would make atonement for our sins. Born as a baby. Tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. And then on the cross of Calvary, becoming our sin. The eternal dying in our place. We marvel. The impossible made possible with God. Father, may Christ be born in us, that we might experience salvation. The impossible made possible. We rejoice in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. We invite you to respond, come to Christ as He would have ask you to. That's why God gave His Son, to invite you to come to Him the only way you can, through that Son that was given. God's going to come lead us in our hymn of invitation.
Would you stand with me, please, as we sing?
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Sing that chorus one more time if you would.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Amen. Thank you, Todd. Thank you for being here with us. Appreciate all those that made donations to the poinsettias. We will get that list in the bulletin in the upcoming weeks. And we appreciate your contributions. Sanctuary is beautiful. Thanks to those that work so hard to set up in here and across the street that got ready for our breakfast over there. A beautiful job, and also our Awana Christmas party this evening. Remember those things that are going on. I will just remind you that proposed budgets are behind the door as you go out to your left. We thank you for being with us today. Remember the opportunities this evening and the days ahead, and be involved in our Christmas celebrations. Brother Todd, lead us in our benediction.
I can't get it. So you will have to bear with me there. Sometimes, like, I can hear a note, and there it is, and this is one of those moments where it's like my hair. It's gone. Here we go, all right. Here we go.
Emmanuel, Emmanuel, His name is called Emmanuel. God with us, revealed in us, His name is called Emmanuel.
Amen. You are dismissed.